Welcome all to my session, Deep Learning with Unicorns and Umbraco. We're going to see a lot of unicorns and also a little bit of Umbraco. My name is Henk Boom. I'm already introduced, but very important, my Twitter and my blog, where you can read everything back what I'm going to tell you today. So if you want to see all the demos and all the things, go to my GitHub or go to my blog. So I think like every person or every developer has like a few moments in his life that he is like, whoa, what is happening? And I had at least three. Of course, I had a little bit more, but three really stood by to me. It's like the first time when I got like a computer and I realized that I could outsource a little bit of my intelligence to that computer so that I didn't need to know what is 1 + 1 and do all those mathematical things, I could let the computer do that. So that was really cool, and I was like, wow, and starting to use computers. The second thing was when that thing got connected to the internet, and I didn't have to go to the library anymore, read a book, make notes, and come home. I could just look it up from everywhere. And now the third thing is, I'm a programmer since 2000 something. And I've been all the time typing if, then, else, while, for, do this, do that. And now with the dawn of AI and AI being available for developers, I don't have to do that anymore. I can give it like a bunch of examples, hit a run button, and the computer will figure out all those if, then, else for me. So I'm going to show you how to do that using Microsoft technology. So what are we going to talk about? I'm going to give you like a brief overview of like the Azure platform, the Azure AI platform. We're going to look a little bit how the data science process looks, so you understand what the data scientist has to do to make machine learning work. We're actually going to use Azure Machine Learning Service to create a custom vision model, and then we can consume it in Umbraco. But is very, very easy. So machine learning, what is it anyway? I already told it a little bit, but it is the ability to learn without being explicitly programmed. So you give your computer a bunch of examples, and it will figure out an algorithm, and it delivers you a model. So machine learning on Azure. They divided it in 5 layers. So we have like the first layer, and that are services, like cognitive services you can consume. So they train the models, they maintain the models, and they expose it through an API for you. So that are cognitive services. They're in vision and speech and a lot of other different areas. And at the moment, there are 42 different services you can use. They support all the popular frameworks. So it is not Microsoft only. You can run PyTorch on it, which is Python. You can run TensorFlow and Keras on it. So that is all non-Microsoft technology. So you can use all the popular frameworks on their stack. They have a lot of services available that make it easy for you as developers, for us and data scientists, to actually do the custom machine learning. So you can run Azure Databricks or use Azure Machine Learning Service. And there are a bunch of pre-installed virtual machines with all the tooling and open source tooling installed for you. Of course, they have a lot of machines, virtual machines, GPUs for you to use, because training a model takes a lot of GPUs. So they have them for you, and they're expensive. And there is flexible deployment. They can help you deploy everything in the cloud using Docker or Azure DevOps or whatever you want. So if you zoom into the pre-trained models, they're divided into 4 regions. So we have vision, speech, language, and knowledge. So vision, to make your application see what is going on. Speech, to talk and to listen to you. Language, to understand what is being spoken. And knowledge, you can tap into the knowledge of internet and get entities and other cool things back. So there's a face API that can detect faces. It also detects emotions. It's always angry, trust me. There is a computer vision API. you give it an image, and it will describe what is on the image. So you get, if you send this image, you get back a man jumping through the air while riding a skateboard. Can detect celebrities in it, can even tell you exactly where they are in the picture. It has an OCR function, so if you need to read text in images, just run it through there and you get back the bounding box and the text. And there is a custom vision service where you can upload your own images and you can create your own custom model without even programming. I will show you how that works a bit later. There is Azure Machine Learning Studio, where you can drag and drop your machine learning model. So you make a pipeline, you hit run, and it will run and train your model. You don't need to have any knowledge of what is going on under the hood. It will just build it for you. So if we look at that layer of the Microsoft AI platform, we have out-of-the-box services like computer vision. It's an API, you send an image, you get things back. You can't influence it at all. You have configurable services, like the face API. That API you can use to train on your own faces, and it can recognize them. So you just give it a few samples of your face, and it will train a model for you. You have bring your own data services, like you throw in a bunch of data, like I want to classify dogs and cats. So you throw in like 10,000 images of dogs and cats, and the machine learning, the custom vision service will do the rest. So that is bring your own data services. And you have drag and drop tools like Azure Machine Learning Service. So that is like the beginner level of AI to really see what you can do. And I always say, if you want to start with machine learning or want to do something with AI, always look first if it is available in this stack. Because it is easy. It is most of the time just calling an API or using an SDK in C#. And it will save you a lot of time, and it will save you like hiring a lot of data scientists to clean your data. So do that first, before you start doing a real data science project, which takes a lot of time. So we are going to answer in this hour, or 45 minutes, or half an hour, is it a unicorn or is it a horse? And we're going to make a machine learning model that can differentiate those two from each other. But first, we're going to have a look at how the data science process looks like. It consists of at least 6 steps that are the minimum you need for a successful project. So you have to start with asking a sharp question. If you formulated the question, you need to gather your data. If you have your data, you need to prepare the data so it can run through your algorithm. You have to select an algorithm, train your model, and then use the answer. So if we have a look at the first thing you have to do is ask a sharp question. And what is a sharp question? So you can actually only ask 5 questions to a machine learning algorithm. And that is how much or how many? Is it this or is it that? Is it weird? To which group does it belong to? Or which action should I take? So that are the 5 questions you can ask. You can ask it, of course, in a lot of different ways. So for this example, I'm going to use now, in this show you how the process works, is what is the price of a second-hand car? So to answer that question, I need data. And the data you can gather from your own data source, but there are also lots of websites like Kaggle or UCU or Azure Machine Learning where you can grab like sample data. And if you just want to train yourself for machine learning, you can just go to like Kaggle, grab a data set and start using it. So I went to the website Kaggle and I got like a little bit cleaned data set of car sales all over the United States for the past 20 years. So that was really handy for me. So you see, I got like a CSV file with all those fields in it. So now I needed to prepare, I got the data. So now I needed to prepare the data to actually run through my model. So then you have to zoom in a little bit to your data and ask yourselves a few questions Christians with every column you have. And the questions are, is this column relevant to answer my question? Is the column independent, simple, and clean? Meaning relevant, is it really relevant that I have like a column VIN number in my data set to answer my question, what is the price of a secondhand car? I don't think so. And the same even maybe for city or state. So my tip is always take the smallest data set you have, and then you can always add columns to make your machine learning model more complex. Is the data independent? Meaning, are not two columns telling me exactly the same thing? So here, it is like year and the age of the car, which is actually kind of the same thing. So this would count double in my machine learning algorithm, because there are two columns telling the same thing. And that is maybe something I should not have. So I should remove one and keep the simplest. Coming to this one, keep your data simple, simple enough. Do I really need to specify all those different models? Or can I just go with like the simple thing, like Encore, just Encore and not just the type of the car and not like the subtype of the car. So I cleaned it up and made it like this. Another thing, you don't want to have crap in your data set. If you have like a little bit of data that is not correct, your machine learning model will also give you a wrong answer. So you have to make sure that the data that goes in is the correct data and is actually true. So here, 2017, 5 mile, is not a second-hand car back then in the data set. So I threw all those things out, cleaned up my data set, made it a little bit smaller. Then the fun part starts. This process mostly takes up 80% of your time and 80% of your budget. So after that, you only have like a limited amount of time to actually do the machine learning, and you don't need to do much anyway if you have figured out that your data is correct. So when your data is fine, you can select your algorithm. And luckily, there are a lot of cheat sheets for that. So you just follow some errors, Google, and you take like 5 algorithms that might solve your problem. So in this case, one of these 5 should give me like a good result. And then I have my 5 algorithms I want to try out, and then I can start with the training. And the process of the training mostly looks like this. So you import your data, you do a little bit of pre-processing, making categories, telling it this is an integer, this is a string. So you do a little bit of that. You split your data set, 20% for testing and validating your model, and 80 or 70% for training. So you train the model, and then you score the model against your 20% test data. So you run all those records and see if you are correct with your prediction. And then you evaluate it, it gets like a score, 0.8% accurate, and then you have your model ready. And if you look at Azure Machine Learning Studio, you can just drag and drop all those components here and hit a run button. So here you see I'm using 2 different algorithms and let them run against each other. I score them both, and then when I evaluate, I see which model performs the best against the test set. And then, when you have that model, you actually have to do something with it. And mostly, when you're proving yourself, a lot of companies leave the model lying around and don't put it in production, because how do you put a model in production? So that can be done in a lot of different ways. You can wrap them in a Docker container. Microsoft can host them for you, of course. So it just deploys it for you, you get some nice stats. But you can also, most of the times, download your model and actually run it in serverless. So this is really cool. And it goes very fast. And if you convert it to an ONNX standard, you can even run it locally on a Raspberry Pi on Windows IoT, for instance, but also on Linux, of course. It is Linux. So one thing you have to remember about the data science process is if you put in limited data, if your data set is not big enough, not diverse enough, not like biased enough, or it has wrong values in it, your AI will be a reflection of that because it looks at your past data and it will actually never learn something new. It always looks back at the data you're given and does an assumption. So if you feed it with the wrong information, your AI model will be very crappy. So back to the question, is it a unicorn or is it a horse? So we can solve that problem in three different ways. We can try and use one of the cognitive services. And in this case, we can use computer vision. So we send an image to there, to their API, and we get back the results. And the results look like this. So I now send a horse, and it will tell me that it is a horse, and it will also tell me where it is. Really handy, really cool. But it doesn't really work with a unicorn. It will tell me this is a close-up of a cow. And even if you do this, it says a cow looking at the camera. So we need to do something else for this problem. So this problem, if you just want to detect horses, it works. If you want to detect unicorns, it doesn't work. I'm not going to give you the demo. So we have to level up a little bit to make this work. So we can use computer vision for that. And there is also still no coding needed for this solution. So you can download a lot of images from the internet, a lot of horses and a lot of unicorns. And you have to put your safe search on because it's very weird what people do with unicorns and horses. So you download like at least 1,000 images of unicorns and horses. You upload them to a custom vision service. You hit a run button. So take images, upload them, and run it. Wait 5 minutes, and you have your model. And that works. So when you've done that, you've uploaded those images, you run a horse through the model. It's just an API. So you post the image to the API it created for you. And it will tell you, I'm 99% confident that this is a horse. The cool thing from the custom vision service is that besides an API, which Microsoft builds, of course, every request, you can also export those models you've made. You can export it to CoreML to make it run locally on your iPhone. You can to Android, or to TensorFlow, which can run almost everywhere at the moment. ONNX, the new model standard. And it can wrap it up for you in a Docker file with an API you can just deploy in your Kubernetes service or in your Azure Container instance or wherever you can run containers. It will also run locally on your machine. So if you want to do this approach, you have to do three things. So you have to prepare your data, gather your data, train your model, and then, of course, use it. So my data set looks a little bit like this. Like lots of images from horses, lots of images from unicorns. So I will show you from a Jupyter notebook how that can work. So a Jupyter notebook looks like this and consists of cells. In those cells, you can paste code, and then there is a big play button that will run your code. And it shares states of variables between all those cells. So it is really easy to prototype, adjust some code, hit play and see the result, and document your way of working. So you document how you get to a machine learning model. And it is all in Python. So, but it's quite, I think it is easy to read Python code. So we import a lot of dependencies. And there is also an SDK from in Python from the custom vision server. So we import that SDK. And that goes like this, import vision client and so on. So then you start preparing your data. I have two directories, one directory with unicorns and one directory with horses. So I load them into a list. Then this is a piece of code that just shows me the samples that are in my dataset, so I can quickly look if there's nothing weird in it. And then I start training the model. So you have to go to Azure and create a custom vision endpoint. And then you get like two keys. You get like a training key and you get like a prediction key. You start a custom training client, giving those two keys, and it will connect for you in the background to the service. The next thing you have to do is create a project. And when creating a project, you have to choose a domain you're going to use. Like here below you see a list. Is it like in the general domain? Am I going to identify food, landmarks? Are it closes? Are it logos? And maybe you see it that we have here models like with compact behind and a general one without compact behind. And that means that if there is compact behind, then you can export the model to use locally. So I always choose like that because I don't want to be stuck to a Microsoft API. The second thing you do is create some text. So I have unicorns and horses. And then I'm just going to upload all the images, tagging them. This is a unicorn, this is a horse, and that runs for like 5 to 10 minutes. And I upload all the images. Then I execute a train command, and it will just create a model for me. So later on, takes like 4,000 images, it takes around 2-3 minutes for it to be finished. And then you can test your model. So you can do predictions then against the endpoint it has created. So and if I start sending images like this is a unicorn, this is a unicorn, that is a horse, it will tell me exactly, hey, I'm 99% sure that this is a unicorn. I'm like 99% sure this is a unicorn, this is a horse, this is a unicorn. So that is really cool. If you don't want to do Python, I think you should do Python because you can version it and put your whole solution into a GitHub or a version control. So you can actually document your process and version your data. But if you just want to try out, you can go to customvision.ai, log in and create a project. You just give it a name and here you can choose the different types and the different models. So everything I've done in code, you can also do through an interface. And here is the unicorn project that I've created. And here you see all the images that are uploaded. And it is tagged as a horse. You can go to performance. There you see how well your model is scoring at the moment. And you can do, of course, it over and over again. There's a button export. And here you can export your model. So you can run it locally. So if you go back to the notebook, the third part is actually using the model. So I can also ask through the SDK, like, hey, are there any exports? And if there are none, I can just say create an export, create for me a TensorFlow export for this training iteration and for this project. I'll wait a little bit. I have to pull it. Is it ready? 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 And then finally it is ready. Then I can download it. And what I get is a zip file that consists of two files. It is like the model file where all the equations and all the math is in. And I have a file with labels. So in this case, in this TXT file is just horse and unicorn. So I load in that model. That is all sample code available if you go to customvision.ai. And then I can start doing predictions against the local model, meaning I don't have to connect to the cloud and I'm in control how fast it is because I can run it on a very cheap machine or I can run it on a very expensive machine using a lot of GPUs. And here we see that it is luckily performing exactly the same locally as it would be in the cloud. So this notebook you can download and read through if you want to. This is all on my blog later. So, but still, sometimes that is not enough because you can't really look under the hood what this machine learning model is actually doing. So you can't explain what it is doing. So you can level up a little bit more than this. So if we zoom back to machine learning on Azure, we're now going to use Azure Machine Learning Service. We're going to use Keras. And we're going to use some GPUs in the cloud to do this all by ourselves from scratch, also in Python. And we're going to deploy it to the cloud. So Azure Machine Learning Service is a fully managed service for you to keep track of your machine learning experiments. So it helps you document what you are doing. It can version your models because, of course, you train, you experiment, a lot of models come. So it keeps track of which data you've used for which model and where your model is actually deployed. Keras is a framework that lies on top of a lot of popular frameworks. So you hear TensorFlow. And Keras is a framework that controls TensorFlow. And this is made for a little bit more developer people and people that don't want to type like 200 lines of code. So Keras makes that 200 lines of TensorFlow code is 10 lines of Keras code. So that is really awesome, if you ask me. So here we also have to take a few steps to make it work. So first we have to prepare our environment, set up that wall solution that we can track our experiments, deploy things to the cloud, and version our models. Then we can run our experiments, and then we can deploy those experiments actually as a Docker container. So the question is it a unicorn or a horse? So step one, preparing our environment. That can be done in three different ways. So we can do it through the Azure portal, click, click, click. We can do it to VS Code, or we can do it through an Azure Notebook, running a Jupyter Notebook. So Azure Notebooks is the hosted version of a Jupyter Notebook you just saw. And then Microsoft took care of all the dependencies and all the packages installed. So it is quite a hassle of getting all your packages installed. You can compare it with like if you have to install Node.js and then you need like a bunch of packages and dependencies. Yeah, Python can be worse than that. So Microsoft took care of that as the offering Azure Notebooks and it is free. And VS Code has a plugin AI tools for Azure. And then it is just like right-click, create a new experiment, do this, do that, and it will help you a little bit. So don't actually do it through the portal, because it is not versioned. So if you create your Azure Machine Learning workspace, you get like six things. You get compute, models, experiment, images, data stores, and deployments. So compute is the holder where your batch AI clusters are in, where your GPUs are in. Models is like your model store that versions all your models. Experiments is where it keeps track of your experiments, so it sees your performance, see which data you've used, all the log files are stored. Images, when you're done, it will wrap it up like in a Docker image with an API. They're stored there. You have data stores where all your data is versioned, and you have deployments where you can actually track where your container is, which model, what has come from which experiment, so you can go back all the way to your log files. If you look what is created in Azure, you get like Azure Machine Learning Workspace, of course, and you get like a storage account, just a normal regular blob storage. You get a key vault, a regular key vault, a container registry where all your models are being registered, and there is application insights that will help you track performance and how everything works. So creating a workspace, Just run this comments if you have the SDK installed. Give the name, your subscription ID, and a resource name. Write your config file down, and later on you can load all the configuration from with a single line of code, like workspace from config. Second thing you have to do is create your cluster, because you need compute to train your model. And here I'm creating a standard NC6 cluster, meaning that it is the cheapest cluster that has a GPU in it. And the cheapest cluster with one node costs you €600 a month, if you leave it running. So here, that is why it is red, always set your minimum nodes to zero, and your cluster will just shut down, and it will not bill you, and it will spin up when you submit a job. It takes 10 minutes for your cluster to spin up and install itself. So if you're busy doing that all day, set a threshold for shutting it down like to an hour. By default, it is set to 3 minutes, so it will always shut down, and it takes a long time for it to come back up. So you create it. Then it needs storage, so your data has to be somewhere. So you can put it on the default data storage, which is the blob storage that is created, or you can mount like every available blob storage there is by just giving the name, the container, and the account keys. So you don't need to move your data too much, but it has to be on a blob storage. That will be handy. So if you go through the notebook, just Azure Machine Learning node, of course you import like a lot of dependencies again, and very important, the Azure ML SDK. And they update it quite a lot, so keep updating your SDK, otherwise it doesn't work. So we set it up, we can create it, or we can load it by parameters, or we can load it from a config file. The config file so just stores here, and there are just three things in that config file, like the workspace name, the resource group, and the subscription ID. And yeah. So then you load your workspace, and then you can ask, hey, give me all the details from that workspace. And then it will tell you, hey, I'm using this key vault, I'm using this identity principle to connect to everyone. This is the storage account I use, these are my application insights, when it is created and where it actually is. So that is that. Then you can set up your cloud compute. And here I'm misusing a try and catch. I'm trying to create one, I'm trying to connect to one, and if that gives like an exception, I will try to create one. And here you see I give the type of machines I want. You can just look it up in Azure. Also the DS2, V2, and everything you can use. But it is not as fast because it doesn't have GPUs. I give like minimum nodes, maximum nodes, and I'll wait for it to be created. So you only have to do this once, and later on you can just connect to this cluster. So I can ask some details for my cluster. Like, hey, what is the status? Give me the amount of nodes that is running, which VM size you're using, and what is your name? And then it should come back if it wakes up. Yes, can come back. And I have one idle node running, so my Azure subscription is built. So after this, someone remind me to put it off, please. The next thing that you have to do is connect to your data storage. In this case, this name, or you can connect to your own blob storage. So three things while preparing your environment is create a workspace, create your cluster, attach storage. So you have a workspace, you have compute, you have your storage. After that, you can finally start experimenting with the data you have and to create your model. So before that, you need an experiment. And the experiment is like the holder that holds everything together. It keeps track of your log files, your accuracy, which model came out, which compute was being used, which data was being used. So you create your experiment and create a folder which actually contains the scripts that you need to do the machine learning part. So in this case, all my machine learning is in the train.python file. Create the experiment, created the experiment, and then in the experiment, I'm going to create an estimator. And the estimator is the configuration I'm going to use to train my model. So in this case, I'm saying, hey, I'm going to train something with TensorFlow. So give me like a container where TensorFlow at least is installed. I tell it, this is my source directory. Here are my scripts. Here are my training scripts in. So copy all my Python files over. These are my parameters. So in my parameters, I refer to my data storage where my images are. Use my cluster I've just created or I spun up. When you're done with all that, run this training Py, use the GPU, and install some extra packages for me, like install Skylearn, install Keras, please, and install OpenCV. And this is just what you're also doing locally if you have to run install. So this is pip install, and you give a package name and it will install it for you. And then you can run it. So you have created an estimator that is still locally on your PC or in your notebook. So you have to submit that to your cluster. And that you do by experiment, but submit, and then you give it your estimator. So you submit it, and in like 10 seconds, your cluster and Azure knows that you have submitted the job, and you can ask with a plugin the details from the run. So it will stream, while it is training, it will stream the log files, your Python scripts, GIFs, like with print. It will stream it straight back to this console in your notebook. And it will show you real time how your model is being trained. So if you're doing it right, the bar should go up and your accuracy should increase. So when that is done, some models take like 12 hours, 2 weeks, or 3 weeks to train. Some take like 30 seconds. This, with little images, like 200 images, takes like 10 seconds, bam, and it's done. So when you have that, your model is done. It copies everything to the output directory. I will show you later. So when you have the model, you have to register it at your model service. So you say model register, give it a cool name, and point to where the model is. And then it says saved and versioned it. Let me go through that in a real-time scenario. So from the previous set, while we were preparing, we have a workspace, a cluster, and our data store. So we create an experiment, and give it a name, unicorn or horse. We add our training file. So if you want to see my training file, here is a training Py. It's not a very big file. It also imports a lot of dependencies. It gets in the parameters so it knows where the data is. We do some image processing, like relabeling it, scaling it back, doing some other things to make the data clean to go into the model. Then we start the training. We call our layers in Keras. We compile it. We run it for like 100 epochs, so it runs 100 times after each other. And when it is done, it gives you like a file. And all those files are now on your cluster. But you don't want to have those files on your cluster, you want to have them back. So everything you put in your output folder, it will copy back to the experiment automatically for you. So you don't have to worry about copying things from Docker containers and getting it back, it will automatically do that for you as long as you put it in the output directory. So then you have your training file, you create your estimator, link to the data folder, tell here's my compute, execute this, install this extra packages, and then you submit the job. And this is the actual graph that I used for the training of the unicorn and the horse file. And you see it run like 57 seconds. Very fast. So when I got the model back, I ask, hey, give me the files from this run, and it will give me a list. And here you see the two files, the H5 and the JSON file I got back from the training part. I download them and I register them as a model. And then you, of course, want to actually test the model because you haven't seen anything up to that stage. So you can quickly test it locally door loading the model in. and then start evaluating against a test set that, of course, was not in your training data. So this model, I run it again, and it, of course, sees luckily that this is a horse, that is a horse, a unicorn, and so on. So I was able to validate with like 9 images that it is doing somehow of an okay job. So what did we see? What actually happened? There were like a lot of steps behind each other. So at the moment when I submitted my job to the cluster, when I hit that run thing, it made a snapshot of the folder where my training file was in and pushed that over to the experiment. It created underwater a Docker image and configured it with like the packages I gave and everything else. So, and it registered that model even in my Azure Container Registry. So you can actually pick it up and run it locally. Then it deployed that Docker image to my compute cluster. It mounted my data store, so it mounted like the blob storage to that Docker container. And then it launched my training script. And it just did what I wanted it to do. I had total control over every line of code there. During the run of the training pipe, the training script, it streamed back through the experiment all the log files directly to my Jupyter notebook so I could follow what was going on. And then when it was done, it copied over the output to my experiment. So everything's safely there. So step two, experimenting and getting actually a model. Let's create the experiment, create the training file which actually does the machine learning, configure the experiment, run the experiment, and register the model from the experiment. So now you're at the state that your model is hanging in a model registry for anyone you want to use it. We come to the third and final step, and that is deploy our model into production. So for that, it can also create an image for you. So we need a model. We need, of course, a Python file, in this case core.py, that will execute the model. And we need an environment file. And those three combined will give us a Docker image, which you can deploy everywhere where we want. So a scoring file has to look like this. So it needs an init method that will be executed when the first time the container boots up. So there you load in your model and do everything else you want. And then when you post something to the URL of your Docker container, this thing, this method, the run method is executed and it gets back inside raw data. So that can be the raw data from the image, but in this case I want it to be a JSON file that just points to the location of the image. So this one downloads it, resizes it and runs it through the model and gives a prediction and then gives me back a JSON like I'm 99% sure that this is a unicorn or this is a horse. The environment file we already sort a little bit tells us which additional packages has to be installed. So Keras, I need Keras to be installed, I need OpenCV to be installed. So it is just basically a list of packages. When you have those three things, you can create the image. So we create a configuration. Hey, you need to have a Python runtime. This is my scoring script, this is my environment file. This is the workspace and this is the model. So with all those things, you can create an image. And those images are versioned in Azure Container, Container Registry, and you can also have a look at them in Azure Machine Learning Studio in the portal, where you can see back, where you can trace back everything that was done. So then you have the model, you can deploy it to an Azure Container instance, to a Kubernetes service with Python code, but you can also let Azure DevOps do it for you. Deployments to ACS, you can do by just saying, I need 2 GB of memory, give me one core. You can spin it up as big as you want. You say deploy, You wait a little bit and it is there. I don't think this is the way, but it is very good for prototyping and see if your container actually runs. Because I think you should use Azure DevOps or any continuous deployment tool to take it on from there and not do that from your local computer. Oh, but to show you how you can prototype it, you can deploy it. We create like the scoring py file with the run and the init function, create our environment. We build the Docker container. Takes 15 minutes for a Docker container to be built. It's quite slow. So make sure you don't have any bugs in your scoring py, because you have to do that over and over. You deploy it to Azure Kubernetes instance. You can create a new one or update an existing one. And then you can start testing it. So I have like random, not so random, but like 6 images from unicorns and horses. And I'm just going to submit them with the REST calls to my container. And luckily here I also get back, this is a unicorn and this is a horse. So if you want to see how you can do it to AKS, you can later on download this notebook and it will also create this complete cluster for you and puts in load balancing and all those things for you. So deploying a model is basically having the files, creating the Docker images, and then deploying that Docker image to somewhere. The stages we went through, we have first prepared our data. You can do that in any tool you want. Don't need Azure for that. You can experiment in your own tools. You can use Jupyter Notebooks. You can use VS Code or whatever. You can train and experiment on Azure. It will version everything for you. And then I think the biggest advantage of this package is that it has the model registry for you, where you keep track of the models, and those models are not on your local computer or in like a file directory somewhere on a server. Deploy, build an image from that, and deploy it wherever you want. So prepare, experiment, and deploy. So we've seen 3 things how you can solve like a vision problem. Computer vision, out of the box, just post to an API. Custom vision, you have to bring some of your data, but it is still calling an API in the end. And also Azure Machine Learning Service is bringing your own data, build your own script, but still at the end for a developer, it is calling an API. So from Umbraco, how do you use this? Just call an API in every controller or every safe action. Just call a REST endpoint, get the JSON back, and handle it however you would handle a REST call. So thank you for listening and listening to Python and everything. Here is all the code if you want to read it again or try it yourself. And the code is also on GitHub. So enjoy your lunch. Thank you.